Nancy is working at CORE in the United Kingdom as Open Access Aggregation Officer, and she is involved in two very interesting projects about open access and open science, like Foster and Open Minded. Before we properly start, I would like to remind you that you can type whatever question you have in the chat, or go to menti.com using the code 489563. I'm just typing it in the chat again for your convenience, and ask your question in a totally anonymous way in case you are you feel shy about asking questions directly. We already collected a few questions on Mentimeter, so before asking Nancy to answer them, I would like to also remind you that we are going to have a full webinar with Open Minded tomorrow at 2 p.m. with Nancy again, and you are much more welcome to join it. Nancy, would you like to introduce briefly what are the main topics for the webinar tomorrow?
Ilaria, I think that I don't have a webinar tomorrow on Open Minded.
Oh. Oh, God.
There is one, but I don't think it's Ilaria who's going to... it's Nancy who's going to present, Ilaria.
Okay, because I was a little bit confused.
Okay, that's embarrassing. And that's my fault. So sorry, everybody. There's going to be a webinar tomorrow about Open Minded without Nancy.
But on my presentation on text and data mining and machine readability, which I have done already and it's already recorded, I present the work that we did in the Open Minded project. And because the Open Minded project was a very technical project in parts of it, what I presented was the part that it was not technical and the work that we did for librarians and research support administrative staff. So okay. If the people want to find out more about this before they watch tomorrow's webinar so that they get the full picture, I think that it would be good if they haven't done so already to go back and watch the webinar that I gave on TDM and machine readability. And then they can also come tomorrow on your webinar tomorrow.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Nancy. And apologies all for messing up this, but it's a very hard week this week with all these webinars. So I'm putting the recordings of the webinar that Nancy already recorded about text and data mining and machine readability of open access research in the chat. And please remember that this webinar, well, this tutorial has been already recorded and it's available on the page collecting information about the Open Access Week on the Open Air website. Okay, so just to kickstart this question and answer session, I will share my screen for you, Nancy, to read the questions that have already been asked.
All right.
Okay, are you able to see anything?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so the floor is yours.
So the question is text and data mining something a librarian, not IT skilled person, can approach? And that is a very good question. And before I answer this question, let me tell you that I am not an IT skilled person. I am a librarian. My undergraduate degree is purely in library science. And in the past, I have worked in libraries, both as a simple librarian, dealing with the day-to-day aspects of a library. And after my PhD, I moved and I became a repository manager, but I was located in a library. So I'm not a technical person and I don't approach text and data mining from an IT point of view. And that said, the IT point of view or the technical point of view is only one aspect of text and data mining. And maybe this can be difficult if you are not familiar with the technical components of text and data mining, and I don't expect and I think that no one does, we don't expect all librarians out of the sudden to start studying, let's say, computer science, or in a magic way to start developing technical skills. But nonetheless, there are other components of text and data mining, and one of those are the legal components around it. And as far as I can tell, based from my experience as a former librarian, but also from my librarian colleagues that I have seen throughout the years, is that librarians are the ones who know the law well, and they know the copyright law very well, and they know how to interpret the copyright law. So the legal aspects of text and data mining relate to the copyright laws. And
can you mute your microphone when joining? Okay, please go
and
on.
Related to the fact that when an output is accessible for people to read, is not equally accessible for machines to read. And those are the small tricks of the copyright law that librarians know very well how to use. And the other component that relates a lot to the legal stuff and moves us also to the practical organizational policies stuff is that librarians are the ones who in the past have pointed those parts of the organization or those parts in the law that create a barrier in the promotion and engagement of the user with a specific practice or with a specific tool. So that is a second part that libraries could get be and librarians and the research support administrators in general could be involved with. And those are the policies, for example, that funders or big organizations create, and librarians and repository and research support staff, what can do is that they can discuss with those people, provide feedback and comments on those limitations, on those difficult areas where one practice cannot be applied, and push for a change in the system. For example, here in the UK, people who are not from the UK may not be aware, but very recently we have an exception in the copyright law for TDM practices, and the law says that everyone that has a lawful right to the content, let's say that a person is affiliated with an academic institution like a university, if the university subscribes to the resources a single publisher or from many publishers, and the person has lawful right to access those resources, then the person can practice text and data mining without having to make a single agreements per publisher. So this is an exception for the UK in the law, but those who want to support the practice of text and data mining can push for similar exceptions in other in the laws per country. And something similar we also see that the European Union is also going towards a more free and open law that is going to enable text and data mining for research purposes only. Pardon, I'm feeling a little bit under the weather lately. And the last thing that I wanted to point out is that it is the librarians or the people who are doing research support and not necessarily have a library degree but work in a similar environment, is that those people in the past have been doing the training for all the new trends that come up. In the past, it used to be information literacy. And then it used to be open access. And then further on, maybe it used to be research data management. Or they also provide training on other tools that researchers or students use, such as the citation system tools and deposits, for example, in a repository. And in a similar way, what libraries can do is that they create training at text and data mining. Now, you may think, oh, a librarian is not a technical person. How is the librarian going to be in position to create training on text and data mining? Again, this doesn't have to be a technical training. You can leave a technical training to a person who has technical skills, and maybe this needs to be at a departmental level, because take into consideration that not all your students or researchers will need to know the technical parts of text and data mining. But what they may need to know is, for example, resources where they can go and collect text and data, collect a large corpus of information for text and data mining purposes. Or, for example, a student, a PhD student that you may have in your team, or a researcher in history. Perhaps this person doesn't have the skills to perform text and data mining, but it would be good for this person to know that there are text and data mining practices out there, and these text and data mining practices have certain benefits in the discovery of knowledge and information that could be useful to them. And to back up what I am saying, for example, is that the MIT libraries, and I'm going to paste the note in the chat area, and I think that I will do it correctly. So I'm sharing a link in the chat area. This is a very simple page from the MIT library pages, which lists the APIs that come from organizations, institutions, or services that have scholarly communications content. So workshops and trainings do not have to be necessarily technically, but they can be also but they can be around the organizational stuff about text and data mining, about the policies stuff about text and data mining, and about the legal stuff around text and data mining. And don't take it for granted that even the IT skilled persons who perform text and data mining are familiar with the legal stuff around text and data mining. After my experience I had with the Open Minded project, we realized that there are people who performed text and data mining without being 100% sure that they could do it, that they were doing this without infringing any part of copyright. And we've also seen cases where people wanted to perform text and data mining, but they wouldn't do it in the end because, again, they were not quite sure about the legal issues around the text that they wanted to work with. So I think that there is room for libraries and not IT skilled persons to work around the subject of text and data mining.
Yeah, thanks, Nancy. That's good to know that libraries can play a role, a relevant role in different, well, in a wider area than libraries themselves. That's very interesting. Okay, next question is about what are the practical uses of TDM?
So, in my mind, and I will say this because I do not come from a company, and because my focus on and my interest on text and data mining is more applying text and data mining to open access content, because nowadays we are in a position to say that there is lots of open access content out there. I will briefly say what are the practical uses on the business side of you, and I'm not going to explore this further, but I will focus more on the research point of view and on the content that we can use that already is open access. Sorry. But before I say that, I would like to say that so from the business point of view, there are a lot of things that can happen that relate to knowledge management, for example, or can relate to cybercrime prevention. Or there are a lot of text and data mining companies or businesses that do those. There are a lot of businesses that do text and data mining practices in order to help their customers. For example, we all go to supermarkets, and the vast majority of them now, they have those supermarket loyalty cards that every time you buy something, you have to scan your cards. One of the reasons that these cards exist is because these cards, on the background, they collect information about your shopping habits, and then the supermarket is going to be able to help you with your future needs. And that's why whenever you get this card comes in with glued on a piece of paper, and there are like tiny little letters at the back of the paper that pretty much none of us reads, because this is what they say. They say that they're going to collect information from your shopping activities and habits so that they can formulate services for the users. And also text and data mining is used a lot in the web searches, and all major web search engines use text and data mining. In general, for text and data mining to be a successful practice, the people who perform text and data mining, they need a very large corpus of data or text or whatever that may be. And this is why text and data mining is more successful when the corpus of information is very large. So that is one point to have in mind. And the other point to have in mind, which brings me to the researcher point of view, is that do not take for granted that everything that people's eyes can read, machines can read as well. And I have developed this very well in the webinar that I gave a couple of weeks ago, that is already on YouTube, and you can watch. So from the non-business point of view, but from the researcher, scholarly communications and scholarly outputs point of view, we need to have two prerequisites in mind. The first one is the large corpus, and the second one is an open license. And that is what makes the use of an open license very important. Because currently, especially with the repositories, there is a lot of content in the repositories where a user can go in and download or maybe read, but this doesn't necessarily mean that machines can do the same thing, or this doesn't necessarily mean that people can use for text and data mining purposes. But from the scholarly communications point of view, which was also the focus of the open-minded project, one of the practical issues of TDM is, for example, mining bibliographic data. And that is something that happens a lot with the data that we have in the project that I am currently working on, which is CORE. CORE is an aggregator, a harvester of open access content, and it harvests repositories and journals, both pure open access journals, but also hybrid gold open access journals. And then we have all this information, we give all this information out to the end user for free via our API. And then users can get in there and they can get bibliographic data for specific topics that they are interested in. And users can also conduct the practice of what is called in TDM as sentiment analysis. Now, I know that I'm using a little bit of jargon, and as I said earlier, I'm not a technical person, so I'm not going to tell you how sentiment analysis can be done. I'm not familiar on how sentiment analysis is performed, but what I can tell you is that with sentiment analysis, for example, someone can understand the meaning of the papers. Is this positive or is this negative? For example, there is one paper in the medical subject field which has a very large number of citations. And people may think, oh, that is a very good paper because the citations are very large. But nonetheless, this has a very big number of citations because those are negative citations. People cite this paper on their literature to indicate that something negative was and wrongly was discovered, and they want, for example, in the area where it says, you know, be careful, don't do those things, they want to say, don't do those things that this X paper has done. So with sentiment analysis, not only people are able to find the meaning of the papers, but they are able to find also if there is like a positive meaning or a negative meaning. And because the corpus of the information that we have today, it's so large that people, even though if they were reading the papers 24/7, and if we have said that for some weird reason they can digest all this information and make the connections, which is not humanly possible, then they wouldn't be able to find all this information. For example, another part, like practical issue of text and data mining, is what we call document summarization. And by this, you can understand that there are techniques where someone can quickly find out which are the main concepts in a document. So to go back to the historian example that I gave earlier, so let's say that there is a researcher or a PhD student in history and is not aware of text and data mining. If this researcher or a PhD student learns about text and data mining, then can have someone else who is an IT person to perform, for example, document summarization, and mainly provide the concepts of the documents. And then this technique is going to be able to find out from thousands of papers which hundreds of papers are useful for the researcher or the PhD student. And then there are also other techniques so that those papers can be narrowed down to the correct papers that the researcher needs. And maybe you will think, well, yes, but we have those databases that where we search, like ProQuest and EBSCO and all those things. But bear in mind that those databases, they have certain fields. They perform searches either on the title or the text or in the abstract without necessarily performing those practices of text and data mining.
Thanks.
And those who don't have technical skills, but nonetheless would like to see a little bit of how text and data mining practices and different practical issues are being performed. In the course that we created for the open-minded project, we tried to create some exercises which were not technical, and we give also instruction on how people can perform those those exercises, and we use the core API, a limited volume of the core API, so that we show what are the possibilities around text and data mining in a way that it's going to be useful to the to those who are not technical. So you can go into the course, and I'm trying to find the URL right now, and you can go into the course and you can try to the technical part. I will paste the link now here in the chat. You can try the technical part, and I hope that you are going to enjoy it.
Thank you very much, Nancy. For the participants, I would like to remind you that this webinar has been recorded, and the links that Nancy is putting in the chat are going to be available on the Open Air portal together with the recordings and the tutorial she has already recorded. There are two more questions. So this one you can see on Mentimeter. Do you have any examples of TDM in humanities and social sciences? I have difficulties convincing my HSS colleagues that this is important.
Oh, that's a very good question. I wish I had this question yesterday, because by now I would have found something. I am afraid that I don't have something, but this person who has asked this question, can you please send either me or Ilaria an email, and I will try to find information and send it to you, because I don't have something right now on the top of my head, but I know that I have seen something, but I cannot locate it right now.
Yeah, I think it's feasible. So please, anyone who raised this question, you can,
I'm going to write my email address at the chat area.
And I'm also putting the open air contact email for the webinars to address this question. Okay, thanks. So there's another question, a long question by Garrett. And Nancy, I suggest that you read it directly from the chat.
Okay. It starts from reusability.
Yeah, exactly.
So reusability of a human system explicit expression of the lines and whenever it's concrete repository of the task. Recent state in the long term to express the lines associated with reason. Okay, so the Gareth poses a very good question, and the question is not so much about text and content, but it's about research data. And this is what makes research data more difficult than open access. In general, I'm not like an expert on research data, and because I got involved in like this open movement earlier on, when research data was not so much the norm, and I got involved more on open access. I am kind of lucky that I was involved more on open access, because research data is more difficult to manage and deal with. Now, I see also that there is another comment that it says this applies to all content types, research papers. So for research papers, the license needs to be open, not only for people, but also for machines. And the same applies for research data. Now, the difficulty with research data is that they appear in various forms that perhaps further work needs to be done so that the data is ready for text and data mining. So that is one thing. Now, with regards to the preservation, this is another important thing, and especially based on the fact that policies do not necessarily talk about openness of research data, but they talk about having the metadata of the research data in a field, in an environment. Most of these cases, this is going to be a repository, which describes the data first, and second describes the license of the data. And then those who are interested into getting access into the data, then they would have, for example, to ask the data owner if the data owner can give access to the data, or if the data owner would allow the practice of text and data mining, depending on what the person that needs to do, if this is allowed, because there are a lot of ethical and legal issues around research data. Now, from what I'm seeing is that there are difficulties with research data in relation to the FAIR component, and I do not feel that we are ready over there, and there is still a lot of work that needs to be done from both sides. Excuse me, there is still need a lot that needs to be done from both sides, both from the academic side and or from the organization who maintains and keeps the repository, and from the other side on educating those who own this data on how to prepare this data so that they can be fair and they can be machine readable.
Thanks, Nancy, for the exhaustive reply. I hope this answers to your question, Garrett. Is there any other curiosity or question from the audience? Are you already familiar with TDM, or is this the first time you are hearing about it? And I have a question for Nancy. What is the most strange question that people usually ask you about TDM?
Ooh, the most strange.
Yeah, because I mean, TDM is kind of a mysterious thing for most of the people, even dealing with open science and open access. So I'm just wondering, what is the strangest question you've already got?
I think that they don't have strange questions, but the first question that comes up in everyone's mind is the question that also was the first question in this webinar, which was, I am not an IT person, I don't have skills, why is text and data mining for me, or what can I do with text and data mining? I think that this is the most common question that I hear, and I cannot say that I have had weird questions, maybe because, and that's my interpretation, it feels that there may be either those who know, because people on computer science or other fields that they are like more technical are familiar with text and data mining, and it's not like a brand new thing. Now, as technology evolves, the field on its own evolves as well. But I think that it has been very lately since the European Union has decided to add text and data mining into its agenda, because it realized the benefits of text and data mining, that now we start talking to other people from other subject fields about this. So I don't think that, I don't remember that I've had like a strange question about it.
Okay, so maybe the most strangest one was already been answered. You still have some time to ask questions if you want from the audience. If not, I would like to thank Nancy a lot for your very, very interesting webinar, the one you recorded, and also for taking the time today to be here with us and, well, reply to these questions. Okay, as I said, the recordings of this webinar will be available next week. And thank you all.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.